We farm about 1,250 acres. We're very diversified. We have corn, wheat, soybeans, field peas, fescue, sunflowers, alfalfa. Our peas are actually grown with canola, so we intercrop field peas and canola. We started no-tilling in 1994, trying to address some pretty serious wind and soil erosion problems, water erosion problems on this farm. We farm some very light, fragile soils, not really typical of the valley. We're kind of on the fringe here. The no-till really has helped to prevent the soil loss, but we really weren't getting to where we wanted to be, so we started introducing cover crops, primarily in 2012 is when it really began. And we started seeing some nice changes, reduced weed pressure, better soil tilth, a little better soil conditions in the spring, having grown cover crops previous. And we kind of moved forward from there. We've used some government programs. We've been involved with the EQIP and CSP programs, which has helped us to offset some of the cost to get started, which has been good. It's been a progression. We've really moved forward. The last 2 years, we're probably pushing 90% cover crops on our acreage.
We do have livestock as well. We run about 150 pair of beef cattle that we do finish in our own feedlot. Something unique is how we have worked really hard to integrate the livestock into our operation. We used to turn them out into the whole 40-50 acre field at a time and kind of give them maybe a week or two to graze. And kind of as we moved into more cover crops, trying to utilize that better and just trying to get a better, more even manure distribution, we've kind of moved into strip grazing. Typically, during the normal year, we're moving them daily. Now when we're into the winters, maybe every 3 to 4 days, we're trying to move cows. And you can really see how that, the manure distribution of that is a lot better, trying to get better integration.
A no-till allowed us, of course, to reduce our fuel usage, our time in the field, which is a nice benefit. And we've added a lot of diversity to the farm, which hasn't necessarily made it easier, or quicker, or simpler, but I think the diversity has really improved our operation. We really feel that the benefits of having that diversity is worth it. We've seen a lot of benefits to our soil. I believe our infiltration is a lot better. Soil tilth is better. Color of the soil is changing. The aggregate stability is better. It's hard to quantify those things, but we're trying. We're starting to do some soil tests, some Haney tests, and looking at those things a little bit. And the other big thing we've noticed is we can get by with less fertility. We're finding with the Haney test in particular, our phosphorus levels are really gotten to be pretty good with the cattle integration. We've really dropped our phosphorus fertilization. Our nitrogen utilization, I think, is better, and using this new machine is helping with that by placing it at a timely fashion in the place where it's needed, when it's needed. We're growing, I believe, 8 different cash crops this year, down from 11 last year. Sunflowers was one we added, and we wanted to be able to interseed it, which we've done. We're trying to use pollinators in that situation so we can provide a habitat for beneficial insects so we don't have predatory insects bothering our sunflowers as much.
So in our sunflower cover crop, kind of our goal is to have something flowering almost at all the time. So it's kind of like a little relay. Some of the things in our interseeding mix for the cover crop is things like buckwheat, that is a very good flower. We do a little bit of phacelia, that's a little cost prohibitive, so we don't go too crazy on the rates there. Some of them have field peas. We do put a little annual ryegrass. We are trying to have some sort of cover crop that maybe we can get a little grazing value out of afterwards. So there's a little millet in there as well. Cowpea would be another species that's in there. We're doing a little bit of sun hemp that probably won't bloom. Maybe it'll bloom towards the end, but we're trying to kind of have a lot of diversity is our goal.
We incorporate flax into most of our rotations because it's beneficial to mycorrhizae fungi.
We haven't quite figured out the perfect timing for seeding. Last year we actually drilled it at the same, pretty much the same day before seeding
same
sunflowers.
Day.
This year we decided to wait and do it with the side dresser that we built. And we haven't quite figured out if that timing has been right yet, but we're kind of playing with that.
For corn, we're interseeding at V4 to V5, and we're using quite a number of species. It's based around cereal rye. We want the cereal rye to survive to the next spring for cover crop purposes or living root purposes. But we also have cowpeas, flax, clovers. There's a couple clovers in there. We put a lot of different species in our mixes because you just never know what's going to do well in a given year.
So a lot of people think that a complex cover is really expensive, but really you don't need a lot of anything. say I want maybe 3 flax plants in that 1 foot chunk, 2 rows. So I'm kind of playing with rates, and it's really not very much. It's maybe 1 pound of flax, 2 pounds of cowpeas. It's not much, but I'm just trying to get every species kind of in that foot chunk. Or if I'm doing a complex cover after wheat, or even just a grazing cover, I'm looking at how many plants per square foot. And you really only need 25 to 30 plants per square foot, unless you're maybe a little bit more, but that's kind of what I'm looking for. Maybe 2 turnips in a square foot. So that's really how you can save some money, looking at your rates. The beauty of a complex mix is, well, we've been pretty wet here this year, so some of our species, our brassicas, just don't seem to be doing very well. Maybe it's been the heat as well. Things like cowpeas, which are really doing really well in our interseed mix, that they do very well with heat. So having all of these different things, something's going to shine, something's not going to look good. And maybe if it looks bad at 3-4 years in a row, we'll say, that's probably not the best thing in our mix. But we're seeing things in our mix interseeds now that are a lot better than they were last year. So you're kind of a built-in safety net, I guess, when you have multiple species.
A couple things we've learned too is you need to inoculate some of these species. And we never really did that until this year. This year we've got different kinds of inoculant for different mixes depending on what's in there. So, and I think we're seeing the cowpeas in particular are really doing well this year, and I think that's maybe dependent on an inoculum being beneficial. Another thing about the mixes is the seed size makes a tremendous difference. Mm-hmm. If you've got a small seed, you can afford to put more plants per square foot. If you've got something like a faba bean, you really can't afford more than 1 or 2 per square foot. So that enters into the equation of what's in the mix and how much is in there. This year's been a little bit of a challenge. The previous 2 years, we've had some really great success with our interseeds and with our weed control. This year's been different. We've had steady rain, more rain than normal, and it's really made weed control difficult. I'm the weed control guy, and I've struggled a little bit. A couple of our trials this year haven't left me with many options for weed control. We've kind of learned some lessons. But you need to leave yourself some options for weed control. If you're going to put a non-GMO in your mix, you better have a plan. We're pretty careful with residual herbicides, but we're seeing that we might need to use a little bit more residual herbicides than we have in the past because of a year like this. We're very careful because we want our cover crops to survive. And a lot of these products either have a label for the residual control or they have a grazing restriction. Those are the two things we look at herbicides. Can we graze this after we apply this herbicide? There's not a very long list when you get done taking out long residuals and taking out things you can't graze. So we've been challenged this year by weed control.
One of the trials we're doing this year is a 60-inch corn trial, specifically just for grazing, so we're not planning on harvesting the corn for a cash crop. When we set it up, we decided to do 60-inch corn, and we decided to compare a BMR grazing corn to the Pioneer silage corn that we typically have been using. And so every other row of corn is alternating the BMR versus the silage corn. And so, like David was just saying, one of the challenges is weed control because you can't use glyphosate on the BMR grazing corn. And to make it harder, we added field peas into it at the same time we planted the corn. So we're hoping that we can still get a decent grazing out of it. We're not gonna lose a lot of money on it probably. Hopefully we'll come out pretty good on the grazing side at least. But going into that again, I think there's some things we're gonna change.
We obviously don't farm like everybody around us, but that really is the part of the fun part for us, I guess. We do a lot of educational things, and I believe farmers around us are watching. They maybe aren't jumping on board and doing it, but they're thinking about it. And a lot of times you get that'll work on your soil and your farm, mine's different, and that's okay, and I understand that. But it's changing slowly. I know we have people that we talk to that aren't that far away that are trying some of this, and people through social media that we're interacting with. There's a fellowship of people doing this, so we don't feel like we're out here all by ourselves, but we definitely also feel like we're helping to educate people.
So maybe another unique thing about our farm is the three of us are all coming up with our own out there ideas. So we kind of push each other into, maybe that would work, or we kind of come up with piggyback off of each other's ideas. And we do that well. But we also really have a lot of social, like there's a lot of things. We're on some Facebook groups, some Twitter, even just some friends that are not totally close, but close enough that we can kind of keep tabs on them, see what they're doing. And that really, I think, is where we can learn the most. Because we've got some things we're trying, they've got some things we're trying, and there's a lot of crossover, and there's just a lot of ideas that we can come from each other. And really, a lot of our crazy ideas that we're doing have not been first done here. They've been first done by other people that we've just taken an idea, maybe tweaked it a little, done a little research on what other people have done that has worked or not worked, and we've kind of run with that. The network of soil health is really neat because there's a lot of people doing really cool things that are all related, but all different.
One thing that's really different in this part of the world, we follow a lot of people on Twitter, Facebook, whatever, and you see ideas, and some things aren't gonna work here, you know? We see some really cool things, people rolling down cereal rye that's 6 feet tall and planting green. We plant green, but it isn't 6 feet tall and it's not big enough to roll. So we have to do things different here. And I think you need to accept that. There's things that work here. One of the big reasons we interseed almost all our grow crops and as much as we can is because of that. There's just not a lot of time in the spring or in the fall to get that extra growth. So you've got to get started in crop. That's one of the big lessons we've learned. And cereal rye is king, and we're hoping winter camelina is going to be queen. We're looking for these crops that can be planted late when it's cold, maybe even into September or October, and they can get established and they will grow the next spring. There's not many crops that will do that consistently in this environment.
We've been trying to scale back our fertility, and every time when I make maps, we variable rate things. We don't want to over-fertilize because we've been seeing studies that show that that actually hurts the soil microbes. So we're trying to figure out how much do we pull back. So pretty much in every crop this year, we have some sort of fertility trial that have a couple reps that we're going to see how much we can cut, because we've been learning enough, we've been doing this long enough that we would like to see economically how far we can push things. We're tracking every field cost analysis wise, and so I'm trying to track all that. I also make most of the prescriptions for the fertility as well. I am in the field sometimes when my mom watches my son for me, but my jobs have changed a lot in the last year.
Typically, as kind of a new member here, I guess, I spend a lot of time working on the cattle, and also I do a lot of the planting with the air seeder. In like the fall, like they'll be combining, I'm usually following the combine with the air seeder, pretty much on all the wheat, field peas. So that's, I guess, kind of my big field job, I guess, in which I really enjoy doing that. I like planting stuff. Typically when I'm working with the cattle, most of my work is checking fence and moving them every day, basically. Just making sure that they're moving as often as they need to, make sure they leave enough residue behind, and then also to try to get that more even manure distribution. Typically, I go out every morning, usually, and move cattle from one paddock to the other, or set up poly wire and move them across the field, or whatever that might look like, depending on the time of year. Some benefits of the cattle would be, one, just getting them out on the ground, getting that manure distribution, helps with the nutrient cycling of the crops and also in the pasture. But it also, when managed correctly, you can get a lot of residue distribution trampled. So they're not necessarily eating everything, but they're putting that residue down, getting a good layer of soil armor, which really helps with water infiltration.
The cattle is a big part of this operation and an important part of it, but it's good to have a new focus, have new people on it, and I don't need to necessarily have my hands in everything. So I've kind of concentrated on being the weed control expert and the repairman, crop scout, that kind of thing. So trying to delegate things out and get the new generation involved more and learn more. This field here, not necessarily typical, but we seeded it last fall with the air drill, and we seeded two rows of cereal rye and two rows of winter camelina. We would typically not put two overwintering crops like that. We would normally have a non-wintering, but this field's a little different. We have an experiment through NRCS on this field, testing different species of cover crop. This field was strip-tilled this spring and then seeded with a planter. Terminated the winter camelina and the cereal rye at about emergence of the corn with Roundup and Sharpen. It was before emergence. Then we, at V4 about, we came in here and we seeded the cover crop inside, dressed the nitrogen. My first experience with NRCS was a cover crop incentive program. I think it was a 5-year cost share program, and it was on a very limited acres. It was only on 2 small fields. It didn't really work the easy way. We had to find a new way to make it work. So we did another contract with NRCS to do a larger acreage. And at that time, we were starting to get some of the equipment and some of the ideas that worked. One thing we've always been able to do is we had a certain acreage through NRCS, but we're always able to use the money further than the cost share. So on that first 70 acres, we typically would put cover crop on 120 acres. And we tried to make the most of the program. When I think NRCS programs fail for that is when you do the bare minimum, or you do it just for the money. And that's not the way you should look at it. You should look at it as a way to help you make that step.
So I've talked to people about cover crops, maybe agronomists, and they've said, yes, cover crops are the future, but I think they're now. Like, soil health and cover crops are not the only solution, and not the solution to some of our pest issues or our Roundup resistant weeds. But I think if we start moving into soil health, that actually is going to solve a lot of our problems that are starting to emerge in agriculture. Some of our resistant pests, some of our resistant weeds. A lot of that is because we're not farming with a holistic mind of the soil. So if someone really wanted to get started in soil health, we would say to find someone that's near them, that's doing something that they would like to do or something that they'd like to copy, kind of a mentor, because it's really hard to go about this yourself. Even just the equipment setup alone is really challenging, let alone the species decisions, rates, even just the economics of it, chemicals, a whole nother realm too. So getting someone that can kind of help you get along. The other advice I would give is not to feel like you have to go all in the whole way. A lot of the things, the crazy things we've done, people look at it as crazy, but it's only 6 acres or 10 acres, and that's a big thing. We're okay with maybe trying some of these things. Some of them are going to be awesome and we'll go further, but others, well, we're not going to lose the farm, and that's a big important part. Only risk what will let you sleep at night.
I see soil health as a very important transition, and I feel like if it isn't adopted on a wider scale, we're really in danger of losing our land. I've read where even in Iowa they're talking 40, 50 years of topsoil left at the rate of degradation we have now. That's not acceptable. We need to stop it. It's our responsibility to the next generation to improve our soil.